but that life isn't an easy life. He doesn't give us take away all the problems. Like Jan said, you know, the world's it's tough, it's overwhelming. Three, the indwelling Spirit installs the new believer as a member of Christ's universal church. It's called the baptism of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians 12:13. For by one Spirit are ye all baptized into one body. Whether ye be Jews or Gentiles, be bond or free, have been made to drink of one Spirit. That's where all of us have the same Spirit. Every Christian that has ever been saved has the same Spirit living within them. Four, the indwelling Spirit gives spiritual gifts, God-given abilities for service to the believer. Every believer has spiritual gifts that God has given you, God has given me. And they're there to edify the church, to serve the Lord effectively, and for His glory. We all are equipped. He's equipped us. He hasn't asked you to do anything that He hasn't equipped you to do. Right? 1 Corinthians 12:11 says, but all these worketh that one and selfsame Spirit, dividing every man severally as He will. God gives to each one of us what we need to do His will and to grow in Him and to live the Christian life, the real Christianity. The indwelling Spirit helps the believer understand and apply the Scripture to his daily life. 1 Corinthians 2:1, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. How do you know the things that are freely given to you of God? You spend time in His Word. He drives us. Matter of fact, do you have a hunger for God's Word? If you don't, ask Him, Lord, give me a hunger for Your Word. Because He will. And as you're in His Word, then that's how we know the truth. So the indwelling Spirit enriches the believer's prayer life and intercedes for him in prayer. Romans 8:26-27. I'm going to read this here. This to me is probably one of the most quoted scriptures. One of the most Romans 8:26-27. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which we cannot understand. So you ever feel like you didn't know how to pray? Huh? Does God doesn't leave you there? He takes care of it for us. He's omnipotent, all-powerful God. And what He's saying is, I'm praying for you. I'm praying. You just stay close to me. Stay close to me. Right? With groanings which we cannot be uttered. And verse 27, and he that searches the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. What does it mean to make intercession? Intercession means that he stands in the gap. That when I can't do it, he says, okay, John, I'll take care of this for you. Who would you rather have making intercession for you than Almighty God? Amazing? Amazing. In verse 28 then, and it says that, and this is the verse that, you know, and we know that all things work together for the good to them that love God and who are called according to His purpose. Amen. Huh? Isn't that good? And the literal translation that says that is in ties those three verses together. The literal translation says, because of verse 26 and 27, verse 28 says, we are assured and know that God being a partner in our labor, all things work and are fitting into His plan for good and for those who love God and are called according to His design and His purpose. So, you know, verse that verse is because the Holy Spirit is working, because God is working, all things work together for our lives. It's just wonderful. Also, the Holy Spirit empowers the yielded believer to live for Christ and do His will. Do you want to live for Christ? You want to do His will? Right? It's the Spirit of God. It's Galatians 5:16 says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." Walk in the Spirit. Live in the Spirit. Be in the Spirit right now. That's what He's saying. The Spirit leads the believer in paths of righteousness. Romans 8:14, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God." Sons of God. Sons of God. Right. God is righteous. If we are sons of God, we are righteous. The indwelling Spirit gives evidence of the new life by producing the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22-23. This is a real familiar scripture too. But the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. The fruit is singular. By the way, it's not fruits, it's fruit. The fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit, the definition that I found here is the work which His presence within us accomplishes. The work that His presence within us accomplishes is, anybody know the first one? Love. Love. Joy. Which is happiness, peace. I mean, think about it. God is saying, because you have the Holy Spirit living within you, as you allow me to live, right? You're going to possess love, joy, peace, long suffering. Gentleness, faith. You struggle with faith? Trust me. Meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And that means that you can't bring these changes about through the law. There is no law that produces love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. Law produces guilt. That's what Paul says. You know the law, you're guilty. And the purposes of the law is to let John know he's guilty so that he gets right with Jesus, has the Spirit living within him, and then produces the fruits of the Spirit, or the fruit of the Spirit. So the indwelling Spirit is grieved when a believer sins. Ephesians 4:30 says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you sealed unto the day of redemption." Grieve not the Holy Spirit. What the Holy Spirit does, it convicts the believer, and it convicts the believer so that we confess our sins. He wants us to confess our sins. That's the purpose. So the Lord, so our fellowship with the Lord is restored. In 1 John 1:9, one of my favorite personal scriptures is, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." I have to live there because I sin so much. I get guilty if I don't get back to the, okay, Lord, I got to stand in the truth of, You said that if I confess my sins, that You're faithful and just and I'm righteous. That's how the Holy Spirit works in our lives to keep us growing. The indwelling Spirit seals the believer into the day of redemption so that the believer's arrival in the Lord's presence is guaranteed after this life. Ephesians 1:13 and 14, "In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise." Sealed. Who sealed you? God did. You didn't seal yourself. You were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory. It's the earnest. We've already got it. It is the we have the inheritance. It's coming, folks. Jesus is coming again, and we're sealed with the Spirit. When you accept Christ as your Savior, Romans 10, 9 through 13, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and shall believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. All of us, if we're saved, have done that in one form or another. If that's happened in your life, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in your heart. Period. And he brings with him a new life, an entirely new life, a life of love, a life of relationship, and a life of service. And that's real Christianity. That's what we're hopefully going to be studying here for the next few weeks as we go through this. It's a life of love, relationship, and service to God. It's done. We're there. We stand in that. You don't have to earn it. Now, what do we have to do? Do we have responsibility? You betcha. You betcha. We have a responsibility to obey Him. Now, I can choose to obey God. When the Holy Spirit says to me, John, you sin against me. I mean, I got to tell you, this morning I was working on this lesson really hard, and I'm thinking, John, this is, you know, and God says to me, hey, John, who are you trusting? Me or you? You just stand up there and tell what I'm telling, and let me have the results. You know? When the Holy Spirit is working in our lives, He wants us. He's there so that we do obey Him and get closer to Him. And I'm going to close with Romans 12. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Again, very familiar. We've read it many times before. I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world. We have a responsibility to obey God, to present ourselves as a living sacrifice. And that isn't something we just lay down and let happen. That we be not conformed to this world. That is a choice, folks. That's hard, not to be conformed to this world. But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do you renew your mind? If you're not spending time in the Word of God, you're not renewing your mind. It's the only way I know to renew your mind. There's lots of ways to spend that time. Be ye transformed by that ye may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Your life is, when you're in Christ and you're growing in Christ, your life is proof of the good and acceptable will of God, because you're living it. You're a living example. Now, that's what I got out of my study of the Holy Spirit. I don't know, Jen, if that got the essence of maybe what you were talking about there. And anybody have any questions, comments, or you want to throw anything at me? Yeah.
And so we don't have to keep fighting the same battles over and over and over again. And that's part of God's sanctifying power, getting us ready to meet Him in heaven, where we have embraced this Holy Spirit in us, so that when we transition, the transition should be easy.
Yeah. Yeah. Anybody else have anything you want to add before we close? I appreciate you guys' patience today. Almighty God, thank you again for this opportunity to open your word, Father, to learn of you, Jesus, and for you to teach us, all of us, Lord. And we are so blessed, Lord. We're blessed in this country to have freedom to gather together and worship. We're blessed in this city, Father. We're blessed in it with one another, Father, in this church. You are the one that brought us together here, Lord, and we just were thankful, and we just thank you again in your most holy and precious name. Amen. Thanks, folks.
Thanks be to God who always causes us to triumph. Thanks be to God who gives the victory in his name. Thanks be to God who fills our hearts with joy and gladness. Let all the saints sing praise to the Lord and all his wondrous works proclaim. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name.
Lord, the earth is filled with your glory.
Eternal God, who forever is the same.
And our hearts are filled with your praises.
We join with the angels' song and sing with the heavenly throng who down before him fall. Our thanks be to God, the mighty Lord of all. Almighty God, everlasting Lord, heaven's host before him bow. Saints upon him gaze, magnify his praise. Come and lift your voice and with us rejoice, offering our thanks unto the King of Kings. Thanks be to God who always causes us to triumph. Thanks be to God who gives the victory in his name. Thanks be to God who fills our hearts with joy and gladness.
Let all the saints sing praise to the Lord.
Join in the song with one accord.
All his wondrous works proclaim.
Our thanks be to God, we magnify his name. We magnify his name. Amen.
Amen. Well, let's stand together. We'll sing page 108. Our theme for worship this morning is God's love towards us, and how he shows that in so many different ways. Page 108 specifically talks about the love of God and salvation, and how we could go on and not be able to fully describe how much God loves us. So let's sing together page 108, our hymn of the month, The Love of God.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. Beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bound down with care, God gave his son to win. His very child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels.
We'll sing together on that last.
Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and
well, good morning. It's good to see you this morning. Glad you're here and excited to worship the Lord today. And how about we start with a word of prayer this morning? Brother Pat, would you mind leading us in that?
Father,
and you may be seated as the choir sings.
Amen. Well, let's stand together. We'll continue singing and how we see the love of God each and every day. Page 395, Standing on the Promises, we see God's love through His truth. What a love letter He has written to us so we can know Him, so we can grow in a relationship with Him. Page 395, thankful for the promises that we can stand on.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the God.
Amen. The choir is going to come down. If you would, shake hands, greet those around you, and we'll sing those last verses here in just a moment. Let's sing together on that third verse, standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Let's sing together on that third.
Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
We're going to sing that last as we're singing the last. Kids, you're dismissed to junior church as we sing that fourth verse together.
Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amen. You may be seated, but keep your hymnals out and turn to page number 13. We're going to sing together, Bow the Knee, as we look at the blessings of the love of God. We get the love of His promises, but also the love that we can come to His throne at any time and be able to talk with Him, and we have the privilege to come into God's presence, and we see God's love in that way. So let's sing together, page 13, Bow the Knee.
What a privilege to come into God's presence, just to linger with the One who set me free. As I lift my eyes and see His awesome glory, I remember who He is and bow the knee. Bow the knee, bow the knee. He is King of all the ages, bow the knee. God alone on His throne, see Him high and lift it up and bow the knee. Kneel before Him, all adore Him, as you live to love Him more, bow the knee. In His hand He holds the power of creation, with His voice He spoke when things came to be. Yet He hears each simple prayer I bring before Him, when I humbly seek His face and bow the knee. Bow the knee, bow the knee. He is King of all the ages, bow the knee. God up and bow the knee. Kneel before Him, all adore Him, as you live to love Him more.
Let's sing that chorus one more time together, the chorus.
Bow the knee, bow the knee. He is King of all the ages, bow the knee. God
Amen. Hasn't the music been good this morning? And just getting our hearts ready and prepared to worship. And thank you for that, Pastor Joey. Well, a few things to share with you. First, we have a thank you note. It says, Dear Grace, thank you for the thoughts, prayers, visits, cards, and messages of encouragement. The funeral dinner was a blessing. In His love, that's Michael and Colette Kennett. So praying for them this week. Of course, her grandmother passed away. And appreciate them and thank you for that card. And then we have on the back, you'd see on that table in the foyer, we have our boxes for our college care packages. And so we try to send those out to our college students, keep them encouraged and keep them popular at school with all those goodies. And so if you'd like to help with that, back in the back, you can just grab some snacks, anything you'd like to, put them in those boxes. Or if you'd rather just do a donate money, and Gene can kind of make sure the boxes are filled out evenly, you can do that as well, all right? And if you notice college students that we've missed, let us know. We want to make sure we don't miss anybody, and I want to encourage them. So that's on the back table, and just make note of that, all right? And then tonight's kind of our launching night for 2023. We're calling it Vision Sunday, and we're really going to take this evening. It's going to be more of a church family time, and we're just going to look through our calendar this year. We're going to pray through our calendar this year. We have guys that at the end are going to pray through different categories that really we just need the Lord's hand in and the Lord's help with. And so be here tonight, and we'll get on the same page going forward to this next year. And then right afterwards, we'll have our budget meeting, and that'll kind of set up our finances for the year as well. And so spend some time in prayer for that, if you would. And I'm excited about what the Lord's going to do for us this year and through us. And I think it's going to be an exciting time. Well, men, if you would come, we'll take this morning's tithes and offerings. And while they're coming, I mentioned this in Sunday school, but right before Sunday school, Lucille passed away. Wanda called me. And so pray for them. It's pretty unexpected. And just pray that the Lord would be with the family this week. We know that's a hard thing. John, would you mind taking us to the Lord in prayer?
Yeah.
much, Amy. We turn, if you would, to Genesis chapter 50. Genesis chapter 50. And through the month of January, we've been going through the life of Joseph. And it's hard to believe we are through the month of January already. How's your New Year's resolutions going? Are you doing pretty well? You're looking good. Whatever you're doing is working, so keep it up. And we've kind of worked our way through the life of Joseph, and today we're going to wrap it up. And we're going to be in Genesis chapter 50. And I tell you, whenever, at least for me, maybe not all preachers, but whenever you kind of lay out a series, there are certain passages that you're just excited about preaching. And boy, this is one of them. This is just some great truths in this passage on the area of forgiveness. So let's look at Genesis chapter 50, and if you would, let's skip down to verse 19, and we'll read through verse 21. It says, "And Joseph said unto them," he's speaking to his brothers at this point, the ones that had thrown him in the pit, sold him into Egypt, "Fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring it to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. Now therefore, fear ye not. I will nourish you and your little ones." And he comforted them, and he spake kindly unto them. Let's pray, and let's look at this passage today. Lord, we come to you, and we just thank you for how good you are to us. And Lord, as we come to the area of forgiveness, we can't help but thank you for the forgiveness that you've shown to us. And there's not one of us here that deserved it. There's not one of us here that didn't need it. And yet you were gracious, and you died on a cross, and you offer forgiveness, and we just praise you for that. Lord, I pray that if we're here today, and if there have been people that have hurt us, that have done us wrong, that we would imitate you, that we as a forgiven people would choose to forgive people. And we just thank you for all you've done, and we just pray you'll be with us in this hour. Give me the words, give me your power, I pray. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. I heard about a Sunday school teacher, and she taught her Sunday school lesson on forgiveness. And she got through the lesson at the end. She was trying to ask the kids questions to make sure they understood it. And so she said, "Class, what do you have to do in order for God to forgive you?" And there was kind of quiet in the class for a minute. Then one of the boys shot up his hand and says, "You've got to sin." Now, I tell you, there's some truth to that, isn't there? In order for us to be forgiven, we have to sin. And there's not any of us that have a problem with that. The Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we've all sinned and need forgiveness, amen? But we have also all been sinned against and need to forgive, amen? Every one of us has had someone who has done us wrong at some point. They said something about you that was unfair, is an unfair characterization of you. They did something to your family that just wasn't right. They didn't treat you right in a business deal, and you got the short end of a stick. And every one of us at some point has been treated unfairly. And C.S. Lewis, he said this. He said, "Everyone thinks forgiveness is a lovely thing until they have someone to forgive." Isn't that the truth? Forgiveness is one of those things that's easy to talk about, but it's a lot harder to actually do. God, he talks a lot about forgiveness. And the truth is that in our lives, our relationships will only be as strong as our ability to forgive. God says a lot about forgiveness. I brought a few verses, and if you could put those up on the screen. We see in Ephesians 4:32, he says, "Be you kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you." In Colossians 3:13, he says, "Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye." You see, when he uses the phrase "forgive one another," who's he talking about? He's talking about the church body. When Christ started the church, he knew that unless we could figure out how to forgive each other, this church wouldn't last more than 6 months. A church has to learn to forgive one another in order to keep going. And if we're going to be a church that is going for the Lord, we need to learn to forgive one another. I heard about a church down in Texas, and they had a church split. And the two sides of the church actually went to court over who was going to get the property and the possessions that belonged to the church. And this thing made its way all the way up to the Supreme Court. And when it was in the Supreme Court, one of the reporter did some research on it and traced this thing back. Do you know what the fight started about? It was because one guy at a potluck did not get as big of a piece of dessert as the guy in front of him got at a potluck. Now, as much as we like to eat, we better be careful. You know what I'm saying? And we can do that. If we allow unforgiveness in our church, it will turn what should be small issues into big issues. And if we allow unforgiveness into our church, we're going to become divided and we're not going to make it. And if our church is going to have good relationships, we have to learn to forgive. Now, that's true of a church, but I tell you what, it's also true of individuals. In your life, your relationships will not be stronger than your ability to forgive. Every one of us here, it doesn't matter how good your marriage is, it doesn't matter how much you love your spouse or how much your spouse loves you, there will be times when that spouse hurts you or does something they shouldn't do, or maybe they do something they shouldn't have done, and they're going to hurt you at some point because we're all humans. And the question we have to ask is this: are we going to learn to forgive? Because our relationships will never be stronger than our ability to forgive one another. Ruth Graham, that's the wife of Billy Graham, she said this. She said, a successful marriage is made up of two good forgivers. There's a lot of truth to that. If you're here and you've been treated unfairly through your life, really you just have two options. You can either choose to rehearse what has been done to you, or you can choose to release what has been done to you. You can either choose to rehearse what has been done to you, or you can choose to release what has been done to you. Today we look at Joseph, and he is a man that chose to release the evil that had been done to him. Quick catch up on the story. If you haven't been with us, we have been tracing the story of Joseph through his life. We've called it Journey because really at every stage of his life, he was faithful to God. And there's principles to learn through every stage of his life. And he started out, remember, he was born to what we called a dysfunctional family, and his brothers hated him. They became bitter at him, and they threw him in a pit. And then after that, they sold him on eBay for a few shekels of silver. And then while he was there, he sold on a slave block, and he ends up at this guy Potiphar's house. And there he kind of works his way up the ranks. He's the head honcho among the servants now. And Potiphar's wife gets eyes for Joseph. And she tries to tempt Joseph. And you remember how he had victory over temptation. He had victory over sin. And remember, he lost his coat, but he kept his character. And because of that, Potiphar's wife, in her anger and probably somewhat in her embarrassment, makes up a lie about Joseph. And now he finds himself in prison. And you remember, he works his way up the ranks in the prison. And now he is a prisoner running the prison. And he has two guests that come and stay at his resort. There's a butler and there's a baker. And you remember, as these guys are there, they have these dreams. And Joseph, he interprets these dreams for them. And he tells the butler, he says, hey, when you go back to the palace, remember me. And he thought it went well, but remember, the butler never called. Remember that? And for 2 years, he's sitting there in prison and waiting on God to work. We talked about that last week, how we can prosper in the midst of prisons in our life. Well, we come past the prison, and as quickly as things de-escalated for Joseph in his life, they turned around just as quickly. Because Pharaoh, he had a couple of dreams, and he could not figure out the meaning of these dreams. Remember, the dreams back then had more significance than they mean today. These were God speaking to these people, and he couldn't figure out the meaning of this dream. And so the butler, he hears this, and he goes, I know a guy. I remember a guy that told me all the meanings of my dreams. And so they fetch Joseph out of prison. They put new clothes on him, and they shave him up, and they get him cleaned up, and he comes and he stands before Pharaoh, and he interprets the dream. He says, Pharaoh, I can't interpret your dream, but I know the one that can, and God can give us the interpretation of your dream. And he tells Pharaoh that your dreams mean this. For the next 7 years, there are going to be incredible prosperity in the crops. And you're going to have 7 years of plenty, but after that, there's going to be 7 years of famine. He says, not only is this that the interpretation, but let me give you a suggestion on how to deal with it. You need to take the 7 years, and you need to put someone in charge of that can store up the grain and make reserves so that you can make it through the 7 years of famine. And what's Pharaoh do? He says, well, I think that's a good idea, and I think you're the guy to do it. And all of a sudden, Joseph goes from a zero to a hero in a matter of hours. He is promoted to the second in command in the most powerful nation in the world. And he does his job for 7 years, and he does it well. For 7 years, he stockpiles the grain and he makes reserves. And then the famine hits. And after 2 years of famine, all the nations around them are coming to buy grain from them. And who do you think shows up but his brothers? At this point, it had been 22 years since Joseph had last seen his brothers. He didn't know if his dad was still alive. He didn't know what was going on with the family. And he is there, and he recognizes them, but they don't recognize him. And Joseph then, we see, number one, he is faced with a decision. And he makes the decision to forgive. I want to ask you this question. If you're Joseph, and be honest, don't be super spiritual on me. If Joseph is there in front of you, or if your brothers are there in front of you, and you're Joseph, what do you want to do to them at that point? Anybody else, let's be honest, anybody else want to get a little bit of revenge at that point? To get a little bit even? To make them feel what you felt? If I was Joseph, I'd probably want to make them feel a little bit of the Joseph experience. I think if it was me, I would probably want to dig 10 pits and have a nice little cozy place for each of them for a couple hours. You with me? I may want to take them down the street and have them sold on the slave market and let them be slaves for a couple months. And then I may just let them stay in the prison for a couple months and not to kill them, not long term, but just so they know what I went through. Just so they can feel the pain that they caused me. Anybody else with me? That's the natural inclination of us. When someone hurts us, our natural response is we want them to hurt the same way we hurt. Oh, you ruined my reputation? Okay, well, I'm going to ruin your reputation. Oh, you're going to say hurtful words to me? Well, I'm going to hurt you with my words back. And we tend to take whatever hurt has been given to us and to send it back to those that have sent it to us. And Joseph, he doesn't do that, and he chooses to forgive them. But what's interesting is the fact that when you look at Joseph's life, it seems to be that he had forgiven them long before they had showed up and asked him to forgive. He had not become a bitter man. He was quick and ready to forgive. And even though they hadn't asked for it yet, he had already in his heart granted forgiveness. That's a hard thing. And if we're honest, when someone does us wrong, sometimes we can try to talk ourselves out of forgiving that person. Let me give you a few illustrations. First of all, sometimes when someone hurts us, we respond in our minds with this: it's too big to forgive. We say, well, usually I'm a pretty forgiving person, but the way they hurt my family, that was too far. I'm a pretty good forgiving person, but the way they ruined my reputation, they just crossed the line. The way they abused me, it is unforgivable. And we can put in categories that there are some things that are just too big to forgive. Let me say this carefully, because I do not want to minimize what some of you have been through. But the truth is this. The truth is not that something is too big to forgive. The truth is this. Some things are so big that you don't want to carry them with you the rest of your life. You don't want to carry that burden on your shoulders for the rest of your life. It tells us in Romans 12:19, God says, "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord." God says there's another way. You're walking around and you are carrying the weight and the burden of someone's sin against you from years past, and you say it's too big to let go of, but really the weight of it is crushing you. And God says, let me offer you another way. He says, how about you let me be the one that carries that offense so you don't have to carry it? He says, let me be the one who takes care of vengeance. Let me be the one that takes care of justice, and don't be trying to carry something that you were never meant to carry. When we first got married, and we came back here, the first 2 years on staff of the church, we were the children's pastor, and we would, at summertime, we would take the junior campers down to Hoosier Hills. Anybody been down to Hoosier Hills before? And if you haven't been there, you can kind of figure out what it's like just by the title. And the whole thing is built on this giant hill, you know. Think of Memorial Park type hill, you know. And we would take the campers there. And I remember one time we went, there was a boy, probably third grade, fourth grade, something like that. And his mom did what moms do. And when he went to camp, she thought he was going off to college. And so she had packed this massive suitcase, and he's got this big box fan and big sleeping bag and all this sort of thing. And if you know third or fourth grade boys, they want to carry everything themselves. And so we hop out of the bus, and he's trying to grab the suitcase with the sleeping bag underneath and the box fan and whatever else, and he's just waddling up to registration, you know. And I'm thinking, this is going to be fun, you know. How's this going to play out? We register, and now it's time to go down the big hill down to where all the cabins are at the bottom. And I came up, I said, buddy, you want me to carry that for you? He said, no, I got it, Pastor Brian. He's got it waddling, and he makes it maybe 10 feet down that hill. And the laws of physics start taking over. You with me? And he's dropping things and tripping and all that sort of thing. I came up to him again. I said, are you sure you don't want me to help you? And he goes, well, maybe you can help a little bit, and gives me a suitcase. I tell you, that little third or fourth grade kid, he had no business trying to carry that weight. Amen? Are you with me? Some of you have had people do some things to you that are terrible. But the truth is, if you don't release it, you are going to let them force you to carry the weight of that the rest of your life. And he says, let me offer you another way. Instead of you trying to carry it, how about you trust me with it? Give it to me. Let me be the one that worries about justice, and I will carry it for you. It's too big to forgive, we can tell ourselves sometimes. Sometimes we can say this. Well, we'll say, I can't forgive until I can forget. Well, the truth about it is it's backwards. The truth is you will never be able to forget about it until you forgive it. You'll never be able to move on past what has happened to you until you choose to release that offense. Hebrews 12:15 says, looking diligently, lest any man fail the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Look at the word there that is trouble. The word trouble is literally the word harass. And if you've ever dealt with bitterness, you know that that is a very accurate word the Holy Spirit put into that verse. Because that is what bitterness does. It harasses us. Well, when we refuse to forgive someone, what happens in our minds? We are just consumed with the thought of what that person did. We can't get over it. We lay in bed at night thinking about it. We may be having a great day until we see that person. And all of a sudden, our whole personality changes and it harasses us. And the truth is, you will never be able to get over what they have done to you until you choose to forgive them. It's like holding a hot coal. You say, I'm not going to let this thing go, but the tighter you hold on to it, the more you hurt yourself. And here Joseph, he says, I'm going to forgive so that I can move on with life and see what God has for me. Sometimes we say this, we say, I'll ignore it and time will heal it. I'll ignore it and time will heal it. Well, that sounds really good. The problem is it doesn't work. God tells us in Ephesians 4:26-27, he says, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil. The truth is this. The truth is not I'll ignore it and time will heal it. The truth is time will change you, but not your bitterness. Have you ever seen a bitter person before? What words would you use to describe that person? Cynical, self-focused, miserable, oftentimes lonely. Why? Well, why are they like that? It's because their bitterness was never dealt with, and their bitterness changed them. It made them something they never wanted to be. In week one, we looked at the brothers. You remember how angry they were at Joseph and how bitter they were? And we reminded ourselves that bitterness always has a destination. If you choose to be a bitter person, eventually it will turn you into someone you do not want to be. And we say, I'll ignore it and time will heal it. But the truth is, time won't heal our bitterness, but it will change us. Let me give you fourth of all, if I forgive them, they win. We say, if I forgive them, that means they get a pass on what they did to me. That means that what they did to me will go unpunished, and it's like I'm signing off on it and saying it's okay. Let me remind you, we looked at it a minute ago, but just because we are not the ones in charge of justice doesn't mean there is not one that is in charge of justice. And forgiveness is not the same thing as the absence of consequences. Just because we forgive someone does not mean we restore them to the same level of trust that they had before. Just because we forgive someone doesn't mean we don't report them to the authorities for what they've done. Forgiveness isn't the absence of consequences, but what forgiveness does mean is this: it means we no longer take pleasure in their consequences. God tells us in Matthew 5:44, he says, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." That's what Joseph did. He showed good to those that had mistreated him. And let me give you one final one. Sometimes we tell ourselves, I can refuse to forgive and still be right with God. I can refuse to forgive and still be right with God. We say, well, God understands what they did to me. God understands the hurt they caused, and he's okay with the fact that I'm not forgiving them. I can come to church, and I can worship, and even though I have unforgiveness in my heart, God is okay with that. But the truth is, we are to choose to forgive because we want to be right with God. He tells us in Matthew 23:24, he says, "Therefore, if thou bringest thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar. And go thy way, first be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift." The truth is this: you cannot be right with God unless you are right with others. You cannot be right vertically unless you are right horizontally. And he says, I am not going to be pleased with your worship or your song service or anything you do as long as you are harboring the sin of bitterness in your life. You say, well, Pastor Brian, they're the one that did it. They did this to me. And now you expect me to be the one that forgives them? Why should I do that? I'll tell you why. Because you love the Lord. And you care more about your relationship with the Lord than you do holding on to some vengeance that someone else did to you. We say, I refuse to forgive and still be right with God. But the truth is, we forgive because we want to be right with God. Joseph, he could have been bitter at his brothers, but he wasn't. He could have been petty. Well, I think of Potiphar's wife. Well, what do you think Potiphar's wife thought when Joseph got promoted to second command? He could have been petty. He could have gotten even. He could have gotten revenge, but he didn't. He chose to forgive. We see the decision to forgive. Second of all, we see the display of forgiveness. Look at verse 20. He says, "But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it to do good, meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive." Well, what does it mean to forgive? We throw that word around a lot. What does it actually look like? Well, forgiveness is not condoning or dismissing someone else's behavior. Forgiveness, this is it. Write it down if you're taking notes. It is surrendering my rights to get even. Forgiveness is surrendering my life or my rights to get even. The word forgive is used 127 times in the New Testament. Most times when it is used, it is a word that literally means to release. It's the idea of being set free from, to let something go. Another word that is often used in forgiveness is the word cancel, as in the idea of canceling a debt. And that's what Joseph says to his brothers. He says, "You don't owe me anything." He says, "I've released you to God." He said, "I'm not in the place of God. If I was in the place of God, maybe I'd get revenge, but that's not my position. That is God's position." And so he acknowledged what they did, he released them from it, and he surrendered his right to get even with them for what they had done. There's a guy by the name of Jay Adams. Some would say he's the father of modern biblical counseling. And he said this about forgiveness. He said, "Forgiveness is refusing to bring what someone did to me up to them, to others, or to myself." It's the idea that when I choose to forgive someone, I'm no longer going to hold it over their head. I'm not going to use it as ammo and pull it out the next time we have a fight. Anybody done that before? It's the idea that I am not going to use what they did and tell other people about it to try to win those people to my side of the argument. It's the idea that I'm not going to allow my mind to rehearse and to review what they had done to me, and I'm going to take my thoughts captive, and I'm not going to dwell and rehearse what they've done to me. That's what Joseph did. He refused his right to get even. But I want you to look what he does past that. Look at verse 21. He says, "Now therefore fear ye not, I will nourish you and your little ones." And he comforted them, and he spake kindly unto them. Now, this is where the biblical worldview of forgiveness and the non-biblical view of forgiveness kind of separate ways. Because the world says the idea of forgiveness is, if I just don't retaliate, that's pretty good. But God goes farther. And he's pretty radical in what he says, because he says not only do we refuse to get even, but we go farther to the extent of showing kindness to the one who had harmed us. Joseph said, I'm going to nourish you. I'm going to nourish your little ones. And he comforted them and he spoke kindly unto them. It's the idea that he blessed those that persecuted him. He did good to those that intended evil against him. That's a whole nother level. Joseph, he displayed true forgiveness because he gave up his right to get even. Then finally, I want us to see the depiction of our forgiveness. And as we close our study of Joseph, I want to point out something that we have not mentioned at all through our study so far. And that is, Joseph is an Old Testament type of Jesus Christ. You say, what's that mean? It's the idea that he was a foreshadowing, a picture of the coming Messiah. If you look at the lives of Joseph and Christ, there are incredible parallels between the two. Both were firstborn sons, Christ to Mary and Joseph to Rachel. Both were beloved by their fathers. Both were prophesied to be rulers. Both had brothers that were jealous of them and did not believe them. Both were betrayed by payments of silver. Joseph for 20 shekels of silver and Christ for 30 shekels of silver. Reuben, he wanted to rescue Joseph. And if you remember, Pilate wanted to rescue Jesus. Both of these men were in Egypt. Both left positions of high status in order to become servants. And here's the most important one. Both suffered so that their people could be saved and brought into unity. And both offered forgiveness to those that did not deserve it. Joseph, you look at his life, and I think he is the most impressive example of forgiveness outside of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, you remember when he was nailed on the cross and he was about to give up his life, he said seven statements on the cross. Do you remember the first thing he said while he was on the cross? The first words out of his mouth were, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The Roman soldier that had scourged him did not deserve Christ's forgiveness. The crowd that had chanted for him to be crucified did not deserve his forgiveness. The religious leaders that had orchestrated a mock trial did not deserve his forgiveness, and you and I did not deserve Christ's forgiveness. And the incredible thing is that the very ones that were putting him to death were the very ones that he was dying for. You see, Jesus went on the cross and he paid a debt he did not owe, because we owed a debt we could not pay. And Jesus Christ, he forgave. He paid the debt for our sin. And when we look at Joseph and we look at his forgiveness he gave to his brothers, our mind should automatically go to the forgiveness that Christ has showed us. I've told you before about a lady named Corrie ten Boom. And she was a girl that lived in Holland with her Christian family. And during World War II, when the Nazis really started to persecute and slaughter the Jews, they would bring Jews to their house and they would hide them and protect them. Well, the Nazis found out about this and they said, if you continue to do that, we're going to send you to a concentration camp. And you know the story. Of course, they kept going. And so that's exactly what the Nazis did. They took Corey's father, who was elderly at the time, and sent him to a concentration camp, and it wasn't long until he passed away. And they took Corrie and her sister, and the two of them went to Ravensbrück concentration camp, and there they faced all these atrocities. And it wasn't long before Betsy, Corrie's sister, ended up passing away because of all that they went through. Not long after that, there was a clerical error that actually allowed Corrie to be released. And I can't help but think, as we study the sovereignty of God, that that's no coincidence. And as she's released, she began to travel, and she would gather large audiences that wanted to hear her story, and she would tell them of how she was able to choose forgiveness against these Nazis that had taken her family, taken her freedom, and put her through all these atrocities. And you've probably heard the story. One night she was giving this speech in Germany, and in the back there was a man that looked familiar. And after the time was over, he came up to her And he said, I want you to know that I was in Ravensbrook the same time you were there. And all of a sudden, she was able to put the face with the location and realize that he was one of the guards that had contributed to the death of her sister. And he said, I just want you to know, since then I've come to Christ, I just want to ask you, can you forgive me? And she said she was standing there, and every ounce of her being said, no, I can't forgive you. The anger welled up inside her, and she said as she stood there, she remembered two things. She said, first of all, I remembered how Christ had forgiven me. And then second of all, I remembered that forgiveness is not an emotion. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can act regardless of the temperature of the heart. She said, I extended my hand, and I chose to forgive him. She said, in that moment, she said, I felt the love of Christ in a way that I'd never felt before. Corrie ten Boom, she was famous as she would go and speak. She had a phrase that was attributed to her, and she would say this. She would say, when God chooses to forgive you, he takes your sins, he throws them in the sea of forgetfulness, and posts a sign that says, no fishing allowed. You see, when God forgives sins, you know they're forgiven. God's not going to drudge up something from our past. They are forgiven, and they are forgotten. God tells us that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In other words, if you come to Christ and you confess your sins and you seek his mercy, he will forgive you. And as Corrie said, he will cast your sins in the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered again. Years later, as Corrie got towards the end of her life, she was serving in ministry, still doing the same type of thing. And there were two ladies that she worked with that did something to hurt her. And in Corrie's words, she said that they betrayed her. And she chose to forgive them. And several weeks after this, one of her friends from the States went over to Europe to visit her. And while they're in the office, he said to her, he said, hey, aren't those the two girls that had hurt you? And she said, yes. And in her own words, she said, smugly, but I chose to forgive them. And the man said, well, that's great. He said, how'd it go? How'd they respond? Did they accept your forgiveness? And she said, no. She said, in fact, they didn't even believe that they had done anything to deserve my forgiveness. And then she goes, but I know they did because I have proof. She said, I've got letters in black and white that show that what they did to me was their fault and they betrayed me. And this man looked at her and he said, Corrie, aren't you the one that says that when God forgives, he throws our sins into the sea of forgetfulness and posts a sign that says no fishing? And she said, you got me. She said she went and grabbed the letters from her desk and she threw them in the fire and she chose to forgive. And I thought that was incredible because the woman that was able to forgive the Nazis of taking away her family had let the sin of unforgiveness sneak into her life. I tell you, if we're here today and you've been wronged, you have two choices. You can either rehearse it or you can release it. God says forgiven people should be forgiving people. So how long are you going to hold on to that unfairness from your past? Would you bow with me, every head bowed, every eye closed? And the first question I want to ask you this morning is this, is if you're here and you've never received Christ's forgiveness, you've never let him take your sins and cast them into the sea of forgetfulness, if you've never confessed and thrown yourself at his mercy, and you would like to do that, would you just raise your hand? Say, I don't know that I've been saved. I don't know that I've been forgiven, but boy, that's something I would like to do. I would like to have confidence that I'm forgiven. I'd like to have confidence that I'm going to heaven. If that's you, just slip your hand up. We won't embarrass you. Christian, let me ask you this question. Are there people in your life, are there things from your past that have been left unforgiven? Are there things that you've been ignoring and putting off and allowed that seed of bitterness to be growing in your life and you say, today's the day that gets released? Don't raise your hand. This is between you and the Lord, but if you say that, I would encourage you, go to the Lord this morning. Right now as we pray, release that person to his hand. Say, I'm not going to carry this anymore, Lord. I'm going to trust you with it. And ask the Lord to forgive you for your unforgiveness. And God says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. You pray that as I pray collectively. Lord, we thank you today, first of all, for your forgiveness. And the fact that even on the cross, the thought in your mind was forgiving us for what we had done to you. Lord, I pray that you would not only let that be something that we see in you, but something that we reflect from you. That as forgiven people, we would choose to forgive people. And Lord, we don't deserve your forgiveness, just as some that have hurt us don't deserve our forgiveness. But Lord, today, we pray that anything we've harbored, we would release. And we would give that to you. We would stop carrying on our own. We thank you for it. We thank you that we can have freedom from it. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. Would you stand with me, please? Turn to hymn
263.
Hymn 263 as we sing together. Hymn 263.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Amen. Well, we are looking forward to tonight, and I pray you can be with us as we look forward to this new year, and I pray the Lord will be with us, and looking forward to what he's going to do. Pastor Stan, would you mind just where you are dismissing us in prayer this morning?